So thank you all already. We're obviously having quite an exciting discussion. What we have here is a panel of distinguished, wise persons who all have very different points of view to bring to the table. So we're going to try to unpack a little bit some of the complexity of the issues that we're here to discuss today. As you're all aware, people and governments and from Meredith's presentation, you also see that we're facing a lot of very big challenges. Climate is a big challenge, migration is a challenge, political upheaval. Let's please not discuss the US political situation at all today. I don't want to talk about it. Urbanization, the feeding the 9 billion, and these issues are very complex and meaning that they're very interrelated. They're all affecting each other. And what we see in agriculture is only one aspect of all of those myriad of issues. And what we saw already from Meredith's presentation is that agriculture itself then has a complex set of issues that are interrelated underneath that. So these are not easy questions to get at, and I'll be asking each of the panel members to bring their points of view. But first, one thing I wanted to mention is that we see an awful lot, we see like now an unprecedented political will to actually do something about these complex problems. I'm very excited about it. Last year I was on a high all year long. We got the SDGs. Now have a global sustainability agenda for the planet is instituted. We had the Paris Agreement, which was the first time we've had a new breakthrough in 20 years in climate agreements. We have, in fact, also regional agreements like the 20 by 20 in Latin America and the AFR 100 in Africa, where people are committing, governments are committing large scale to restore degraded lands. And then my own personal favorite, of course, the 4 per mille, which was already mentioned, where the French have brought forward this extremely aspirational and inspirational goal about soil and soil carbon for food security and climate. So we have all of this political will and aspiration that we have never had. So what I want to know from you all before we go to the panel is, how many of you actually believe that we can take all of this and turn it into a change for the future of agriculture, that we can actually, over the next 20 to 30 years, roll out a truly sustainable agriculture and food systems for the planet? How many of you believe we can do that? Maybe stand up. Okay, there's halfway. Okay. And how many of you actually are pretty skeptical still at this point? Yeah. Okay, we got a lot of okay. Yeah. So actually this is quite good. This is great. We have a mix. So we can have some very heated discussions coming from the optimists and the skeptics, and it's really good to have the skeptics in the room, because as we already were introduced earlier, if we all talk to each other about the win-win-win and it's all there in front of us, then we won't really make progress. So I think this is an excellent start for the discussion, to seeing the diversity in the room. So our first panelist I'd like to introduce, Jan Heikop. He's a senior policy officer with the Waterlands and Ecosystems at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in the Netherlands. Now, I just mentioned that there are many important issues and challenges faced by governments, and they have to make decisions with finite resources. So my question to you is, do you think that investing in sustainable intensification of agriculture is a priority over other issues or challenges such as climate, migration, and others?
Well, thank you for the invitation. I'm working in for the Minister of Foreign Trade and Development Cooperation in the department that is called, it's existing since 2 years and a half now, the Inclusive Green Growth Department. And in that department, they put together, the several priorities of the minister: water, food security, climate, energy, just to, with the aim that we should work more together, I suppose, and cross a bit the silos. Myself, I'm based in the food security cluster, And some 2 years ago, we had a policy letter sent to the parliament by the Minister of Development Cooperation and the Minister of Agriculture. And in that policy letter, we have this, the third goal of this policy letter is about sustainable, creating ecological sustainable food systems. So, on the other hand, we have the water cluster, who also sent a policy letter to Parliament. And they also have this, I think it's the third one, a third goal about more efficient use in agriculture, water use in agriculture. And in the climate cluster also, they have these objectives of working within food security, water, energy, just to get our climate goals out of them. So I think there's a real search for, I think with, now your question, in the light of this, I don't see really I don't think it's quite relevant to prioritize in investing or in climate or in migration or in sustainable agriculture, because this, I mean, they're all contributing one to each other. I didn't mention migration yet. I mean, that's I'm not a migration expert, but we know, I don't have to tell you that one of the root causes of migration is also, let's say, lacking perspective in agriculture for young people, land degradation. I heard Monique Barbu of the UNCCD saying 2 weeks ago, I think, in the, she had a speech in the Security Council saying that 100% of the illegal migrants registered in Europe are coming from drought-affected countries. I don't know if it's completely true, but she said that. I mean, so I think that investing in sustainable agriculture is also is the same as investing in climate adaptation and mitigation. And is also investing for the longer term in migration. Don't think that we are going to solve migration by now suddenly investing more in development, because we did it already for 40 years and it didn't, and we still have migration. But, so I don't see a reason to prioritize.
Great, thank you. So you're already, yeah, showing a model whereby these things are interrelated and therefore not necessarily trade-offs, even at a government level, which is nice to hear. My next panel member I'd like to introduce is Dr. Joanne Kuka Kagwanja. She's the chief of the Land Policy Initiative of the African Union and a member of the Steering Committee of the Water, Land and Ecosystem Program. Now, Joanne, just last week, the European Parliament has issued a statement calling for a halt to the funding to the new Alliance for Food Security in Africa. And this primarily, or in part anyway at least, is because they question the ability of these mega PPPs, public-private partnerships with very large international corporations, to actually address the issues of poverty in Africa and food security. So with this as a basis, my question to you is, how do you actually reconcile this issue of large-scale investments in land that's going on all over the world and very strongly in Africa by the private sector and the rights of local communities?
Yeah, I hope I'm speaking amongst friends, first of all, because it's tough. It's tough to pitch, I think, the European Union against a G7 I think, huge program that was initiated by the US. So it's actually quite interesting because you have the whole G8 and then you have members now starting to argue as to whether we are in the right direction in terms of its implementation. And we were involved from, I think this started in February. First, I don't work for the African Union. I do work for the United Nations, but a program that is an African Union program. And I remember in February I was asked to prepare notes for someone from the African Union going to the EU Parliament to speak to this particular issue at the time when this was generated from the civil society, and it came to the attention of the EU and the committee that is involved in food security actually brought it to the floor. It was debated, and at that point is when the African Union was asked to make a response, given that they have a new alliance office of the African Union, so it's quite complex. That's on the one hand. And on the other one is that within the Land Policy Initiative, we've been working closely with colleagues from New Alliance because they have been developing guidelines on the issue of large-scale investments in terms of the very issues that you're raising. And we've made contributions because we ourselves at the African Union level have the guiding principles on large-scale land-based investments. And obviously you know about the voluntary guidelines, which are FAO from the CFS side, and the RAI, which were being negotiated within the CFS. This is the Responsible Agricultural Investment Guidelines. So it's a little sad because the New Alliance wanted to embrace all these guidelines in developing a guideline that would help to develop their frameworks. But it seems like it might have fallen a little short. I think all of us agree with the outcomes in terms of how they are pointed out. Now, I don't want to engage in whether it's right, wrong, but I think we affirm the fact that you do need to look at the issues that are being raised. And we started from the same point, is that there's a recognition, I think, amongst all of us that smallholder agriculture is central to livelihoods, because the majority of those who are engaged in agriculture are smallholder farmers. And if you wanted to engineer development, you might as well start where the people are. So there's no doubt about that. There's also a recognition that there's a lot of land, especially in Africa, that can be brought under sustainable agricultural development. And that's why we had the CADIP, the Comprehensive Agricultural Development Program, saying we need to, one of the pillars is to bring sustainably land under production. The question really is, where is this land? Who claims it? And who has rights? And are they documented in the first place so that you can start engaging on who invests in it? And I think Ruth will tell you that's the crux of it. It's the fact that we actually have systems that about 80 to 90% of the land governance systems of the ones that manage land are actually customary in nature. But the laws that we have only address the remaining 5 to 10%. And that's a real challenge. And that's why the framework and guidelines, it's mentioned in this document by the EU, being very important along with voluntary guidelines to do that. So it's reconciling these investments, small, medium, and large, in a manner that does not disenfranchise the people themselves. And this is the majority of smallholder farmers. So with regard to the guiding principles that we have, the fundamental ones being six of them and an additional 19 of them, they touch on very specific issues in terms of holistic pre-assessment before you engage in large-scale investments, looking at who claims the land and ensuring that they have documented rights, or at least they're involved in the negotiations in a manner that includes them. Reducing conversion of land as much as possible from communities to ensure that land is still held within the communities, or at least having a path for how you reconvert the land back. We don't have that yet. We find that most land has to move from customary systems to the government in order for investors to engage, but there's no path. If that does not work, majority of the times it doesn't, because we have 15% of failure, 15% only coming under production, at least the last time I looked at it, of large-scale investments. It's a very small percentage. Mm-hmm. And so when that fails, what do you do with the land? It has already left the hands where it's supposed to be, and it is exposed then to abuse in terms of once it's with government, what happens to it. So these are real challenges that, you know, we the EU brought it, I think, over months of discussion, and having that resolution passed, it's a real one. And somebody asked earlier, I think when you said, where are the incentives for people to actually do the right thing once you discover the solutions, isn't it? And one of them is actually lies with the donors. I mean, when the European Parliament passes a resolution and says we will not fund, and let me tell you, in those issues of interministerial may be dwarfed by this, because it depends on how much funding actually this means. The fact that donors can have that kind of influence is really powerful in terms of doing the right thing and getting the incentives to do it.
Wow, great, Joanne. So that really puts a little bit of idea why you might want to slow down a little bit on these large scale investments and do the homework and
And try to make sure that they are working for local people. One of the core issues that we're also having in the WLE program, actually, in engaging with these types of initiatives. Our next panel member, as we continue the introductions, is Dr. Ken Irvine, who already introduced himself. professor here at UNESCO-IHE. Yes. He heads the Aquatic Ecosystems Group and their work on wetlands, in particular in Africa. So what I wanted to ask you, so you can introduce your point of view a little bit, is that, you know, our experience with the Waterland and Ecosystem Program, working to put sustainability sort of at the heart and the core of an agricultural development agenda, is that still too often conserving ecosystems and agricultural intensification are seen as completely opposing pathways for the future. How do you actually reconcile the conserving of ecosystems and using of the utilization of ecosystem services with agricultural development?
Okay, thank you very much. I just thought as I sat here a minute ago, I'd like a show of hands on how many people in the room would put themselves in the expert box, the expert panel box of biodiversity or biological conservation. Okay, so there's a handful, okay, which I think is encouraging, because I was a little bit pessimistic that there may have been very few, even fewer hands. Because I think, even though there's like four, I saw four hands, because I think this is the heart of the issue, because, you know, I think we have to frame it. I was really happy that you mentioned in your introduction, Meredith mentioned the bigger picture, the WLE bigger picture. Because this is crucial, you know, we have the biodiversity ACCI targets, we have the sustainable development targets for fresh waters and restoration of 2020. I mean, if you want to be pessimistic, just start thinking about a target for 2020. We are with good documentation in the sixth mass extinction of life on the planet. And we also have a continuing problem of nutrient enrichment. So this is what I want to frame as our thinking for sustainable agriculture, because if you do not have that in your mind, then we are on a path to nowhere, actually, in my opinion. Because we know there needs to be more food production. The FAO and the rhetoric is we need to double food by 2050. It doesn't really matter what the date is, we need more food. How do we get more food? We need more nutrients. We need more water. We need water and nutrients. In the FAO report on, you know, feeding the world, where it had the 2050 targets, in that whole report, and I may have this twisted around, I think phosphorus was mentioned once and nitrogen not at all, or the other way around. So how on earth does anybody think we can actually enhance food production? In particular, I'm interested in sub-Saharan Africa, without thinking about nutrients. And then if we think about nutrients and we look at what's happened in Europe and the States, we only cause more problems by overusing nutrients, and then we have this huge eutrophication problem, which, like biodiversity, has somehow dropped off the mental model. The mental model is crucially important, but our vision needs to be 360 degrees, not, you know, 20 years ago, eutrophication was the biggest issue. Now you hardly hear about it. Biodiversity, the ACCI targets, 2020, I mean, who's paying attention to these issues? So we also have to then think about, if you want sustainable agriculture, and connecting that with the bigger picture, where can that food production occur? So it's a spatial issue. Look at Africa, there are many parts of Africa which you just cannot do this in. So yes, there's lots of land, but you don't necessarily have the land and the water and the nutrients and the markets in the same place. Another crucial important. And if you want to think about ecosystems, we have to somehow reconcile the idea of protected areas. Oh, we have protected areas, which sometimes work and sometimes don't, have big land tenure issues, big equity issues, with the wider countryside approach, which is, again, not on the agenda. So in my opinion, if we need sustainable agriculture, which is going to make this balance, you have to think about the wider countryside and not necessarily have maximum intensification everywhere, because maximum intensification, that last 10% of intensification in croplands and in farming systems, usually causes, you know, 80% of the problems. So looking for a less ambitious maximization of production, perhaps in terms of the wider pictures, is better. And that then brings me to the point which was already mentioned about the global food trade. If you look at a back, there's a beautiful diagram I use in my lecture somewhere where you show, it is just summarized as a global food chain, and it's just extraordinarily complicated. Some of you would have seen it. There's arrows everywhere. And then you superimpose that with climate shifts, and you say, where is the food going to be reliable? Well, maybe, you know, northwest the US, some parts of Europe, can actually produce more food. And my own country, from Ireland, has a policy to produce more, to increase dairy products by 50% over the next few years, not for the domestic consumption, but for export. So there has to be a thinking, a wider systems thinking, a perspective of how do you connect that food production, where food can be enhanced, where perhaps already there is nutrients in the soil, on a sort of nutrient balance basis, with export. And then that difficult some really hard questions, because everybody wants to be self-sufficient in food. Well, I'm sorry, wake up. It's not going to happen. You cannot be self-sufficient in food because there's too many of us. So you need to actually start thinking, where do you cleverly export the food? And that brings in policy and fiscal issues. And you mentioned the new alliance projects and the dangers of that. I've just completed a review on biodiversity and tropical conservation and water. And this issue rises its head about, you know, the USAID, the new alliance of intensification, the Sagard corridor in Tanzania. And what are the benefits and what are the risks? And you've got to get the different perspectives at the table, because if you don't get those perspectives at the table, we stay in the silos. I stay in my nice biodiversity silo or conservation silo. You stay in your nice groundwater silo. And we're all happy complaining about everybody else not understanding us. So until we start talking to the people who we traditionally don't talk to and who traditionally have a different view, we will not achieve the Sustainable Development Goals. And whether I'm positive about the SDGs, I am in principle positive about the SDGs. It is possible. It can happen. 20 years ago, I was positive about the Water Framework Directive in Europe. When I saw it rolled out in the way it was rolled out, I am less positive about its merits, because the devil is in the detail of how you bring policy to practice. And that connection between the upper tier policy, which we do have, mm-hmm. and the lower tier action on the mm-hmm. ground, which continues, we'll talk about later, continues, for example, to degrade wetlands. We have every policy you want to protect wetlands, for example, but actually you go to Tanzania or Kenya or Uganda, and despite all the fancy policies, on the ground, farmer A or farmer B is converting wetlands to rice or to crops, little by little by little, sometimes supported by grants and sometimes not supported by grants, sometimes supported by government policy, but sometimes actually it is the local guys who are making their own decisions on what they can do back to their self-interest, a little bit more food for my family, I will have the short-term vision of more potatoes. Thank you.
Yeah, exactly. Thank you for that. I mean, that's exactly why often in our work now in the CG, we talk not about changing the policies, but actually looking at how they're implemented and what happens on the ground, and that this is actually the entry point to creating change. But I also appreciate that you've made a nice segue to our last panel member, this whole devil's in the details concept. Dr. Claudia Ringler is Deputy Division Director for Environment and Production Technology at the International Food Policy Research Institute, and she's leader of the WLE flagship with the longest name, Managing Resource Variability in Competing Uses. Now, Claudia.
Thanks so much. Yeah, really,
I'd
just like to...
Wait, I have a few questions.
Oh, I'm not allowed to.
No. I have a really good question for you. So, the concept of climate smart agriculture, it has been really taking off, and certainly not without controversy, especially people here in Europe are aware of that. And recently there's a report released by scientists from the Climate Change Agriculture Food Security Program of the CGIAR that focuses on how and how much agriculture can actually be expected to reduce greenhouse gases. So it's a very interesting paper, just came out. And some of the solutions in this report, though, raise a question that I want to ask you, Claudia. That is, can climate smart agriculture actually be sustainability dumb?
Yeah, okay. Very good question, and I guess gets us back to this issue of the devil in the details, right? Mm. So, and maybe going back to just my the previous commenter, so climate smart agriculture, thanks to the FAO, is a term that now embodies the response, I guess, of agriculture to the global climate change challenge. You know, says, okay, we will be productive and profitable. So I think that's the farmer incentive, right? So why do we want to participate in CSA? It also says we'll reduce emissions, and that's what I see is often the entry point that people use. And the other one is adaptation, which remains very vague, very difficult to define. And so that's where we get to this detail. So we just heard, you know, that to produce more food in Africa, you need more nutrients. So nutrients generally means emissions. So do I now have to tell my farmers or colleagues and national agricultural research centers in Africa, sorry, you know, fertilizer is off the funding, won't be funded, supported anymore, will not be part of grants anymore. Does that make sense? Are we really then climate smart? Because we have to reduce emissions. So that's already, you know, a question of which indicators will be used. Is it going to be production per unit of input? Is it going to be, oops, you know, this particular thing, emissions will go up? So, I mean, there's a lot of issues there. And then, I mean, let's go back to the early example on solar pumps. So I think solar pumps, yes, profitable because the costs have come down dramatically. Also productive because we are pumping groundwater, and we've just heard the migration come from those drought-affected areas. So we do need to pump more water in those areas. And generally, you only have groundwater because we just said that they are very drought-affected. But so that's it sounds extremely climate smart. And obviously, yes, now we have solar, so we don't have the emissions anymore. But is it sustainable? That's the big question, and I guess WLE is working towards addressing that. But certainly it's not, I mean, it works perfectly for CSA, but it does not work for sustainability unless you find some other incentives and other ways to bring, you know, to not get farmers to pump it all out, make an income, maybe from solar, but not from pumping all the remaining water out. But will we have time to turn this around, given that we have these very, very high subsidy levels in India? And I guess we here might have a response for that, but I'm extremely worried that we might actually, we are promoting a CSA technology, and you know, if there's not enough support, WLE and other programs to ensure that we are just not pumping out the last ounce of water in drought affected areas, you know, that we will not be able to make the impact that we really need to make there. So that's just one, you know, CSA practice that might not be sustainable unless we turn things dramatically around. Yeah. And the other point that, again, the colleague just before made on, yeah, where can we produce most sustainably? Again, from input per output perspective, you know, the lowest emissions per unit of product are now in the United States, in parts of Europe. So you produce beef and eggs and anything, you know, you get a lot more output per unit of emission produced. So does it mean, as he might have suggested, let's move all the future production from Sub-Saharan Africa to Europe or to the US, so that works well for CSA. But is that what we want to see in terms of sustainable landscapes in Africa? Is that what we want to see in sustainable livelihoods in Africa? And again, we have to be very careful because, as we heard, you know, you set this programs and this criteria, and they will affect future funding streams into those countries, such as Africa, South of the Sahara. And then there's also, of course, a big gender question. You know, is CSA, is it gender equitable? Is it gender blind? We like to put new technologies out on the ground. CGIAR is not the least to blame for that, but of course, also again, donors. So new technology, who will get access to it? Is it the women farmers? Is it the men farmers? Do women get the same information that the men get? Are we increasing the inequity in assets between women and men from climate smart agriculture? Are we promoting no-till, which sounds very CSA, but does it mean women have to weed more? So what's happening to their timings? And so again, I think CSA can be sustainability smart, so to say. But we have to do a lot more work on the institutional side, on the gender side, really to make it a practice that works for everyone.
Great. Thank you, Claudia. So now we have some idea of who the panel members are and some of their points of view. And I want to thank the organizers, Michael and Meredith in particular, for I didn't choose the panel, but we have it's quite a great panel because we have policy, we have academia, we have research and development, we have also from government here, and they have represented very well four key aspects that we actually address in our CGIAR program, especially the waterland ecosystem. We've heard about investment, investment policy, investment decisions. We've heard something about equity, actually quite often, and equity is a major entry point that we have in the program. And we've also heard about this sort of critical thing about if you forget all about ecosystems in the short, in the medium term, we're actually shooting ourselves in the foot. And then also this issue of climate relevance, which is extremely important. Important also in our and the trade-offs that there are amongst different different sorts of aspects. So I really appreciate the diversity that you guys brought out to the table. And now I want to open it up for questions and comments from the audience to the panel. We have let me just identify a few people to start with. So we have Nuhu, we have I've forgotten your name from GIZ. Let's identify a few and then we can just get several comments and then they can respond. Is there someone else who might want to say something? Okay, let's start with.
Okay, thank you very much. Panel, I really enjoyed the point as given by the panelists. But the most interesting one for me was from Joan on the land issue. And I think she did it very well. But we need to then close the loop and saying, how do we use customary land ownership? To attract investment, to support investment. Because certainly, as John, you say, the current approach of trying to change land ownership in Africa to look like European land ownership so that you can attract investment has not worked. So it is the investors that need to change, and they agree to invest their money within the customer land ownership system. And I think we need to, Joanne, maybe you can discuss that. I mean, what do you think about that? And the other people discuss, is it something that we should focus? Because certainly, in many countries, including especially my country, Tanzania, there's no way you're going to get that land to be changed to the ownership that the investors want. It will never happen. And we need to accept that. It will never happen. But then you end up, because now then you end up with people seated on top of a very good land, and they are paupers. They are really very poor, and they are seated on top of a very, very valuable piece of land because of this mismatch of ownership and investment requirement. So I think we need to discuss that and then find something that we can do to actually. We've reached a point where smallholders don't even borrow money from the bank, where they tell each other, "You borrow money, that's the path to losing your land." So they're not letting you even borrow money, okay? Let alone inviting investors. They just see it. You borrow money, you fail to pay, and your land is gone. So they stop each other from even borrowing money, which is a big disaster. So we really need to see how this customer system can. I didn't get your name, although you introduced yourself, just reminding you.
Ken,
okay. So Ken had this issue of quoting FWA about needing more food. I don't think that's correct. I think we are going the wrong direction using that concept. Do we really need to produce more food in terms of expanding area, whatever, or do we need to just be? And for me here, I want to bring the issue of what do you call it? The food culture. I mean, what people eat. I mean, we know all these predictions by FWA are done, think that all people, including people in Africa and India, will eat like Americans. which is not a healthy eating anyway. Okay, so do we really want to take all the Indians, all the Africans into the American diet? Yeah, I mean, because that's how the projection is made. I don't think it is correct. I think there must be a new trajectory, like where the health, the way the healthy Americans are eating, that's why how all the Indians and Africans should eat, not the way the majority of Americans are eating. So and then we need to do new projections with that. That kind of healthy eating and so on. They say exactly what we want to produce. I don't think it is that much. And I really like the point on food trade that you mentioned. But I don't see suggestions of exactly how you make those arrows of yours much better, kind of. So those are my three comments.
Great. Thank you. That's how this one. Yes. Yes.
Yes. I have two questions. One goes a little bit along the same lines concerning the smallholder farming. It actually is obviously much less efficient to do smallholder farming. So wouldn't focus on, of course, the, I mean, if you have a big company investing and producing agricultural products that are exported to the Emirates for horse food or to Europe for biofuels, that's obviously not going to contribute to food security and to livelihoods. But couldn't investment in large-scale agriculture, if it was tied to distribution, I feel that in development policy we always shun the distribution issue. So if it was linked to job creation, to distribution, and to really food production for local use, wouldn't that, I mean, and then would that be a better solution than smallholder farming? And what could be regulatory policy incentive to do this? And the other one was concerning, also again going on the, what would be the policy incentive would be to Claudia, on the fertilizer issue. You pointed out that the use of fertilizer is not climate smart.
I mean, not according to the basic definition.
Okay, but this depends what the fertilizer, I think that's totally true for synthetic fertilizer. If you reuse fecal sludge, for example, if you look at the emissions that I think are not even accounted for of untreated wastewater, of the methane and how do you say
N2O
emissions from wastewater, they're not even accounted for. If you could create an incentive to reuse this fecal matter by maybe taxing synthetic fertilizers, wouldn't that be a policy incentive to make without reducing fertilizer use, but having a different source of fertilizer, you would have a very different climate impact.
I think you're speaking to a subject of very popular in the room with the Waterland Ecosystem Group, the reusing of resources. Let's take a couple more comments so that then we can get the panel to respond. I think you had a comment.
So I'm Marta Pessoa. I'm working in Wageningen University. I'm working with the European Commission advising on future research. And what is rather interesting to see, we are asked as scientists to work multidisciplinary, and the Commission is really interested in these cross-cutting issues, water, food, security, health. But what I do not see is the policymakers working together also, coming out of the silos you were mentioning. What about policy coherence? I don't think the devil is not only in the detail to transferring from policy to the local issues, but it is also among politicians. We know in Europe the common agricultural policy has been enhancing production, causing a lot of environmental problems. So there is a conflict between policies. This is at continental level, but I guess it's happening the same in other places. So I would like to ask, especially people working on policy, what are your views on this need for more policy coherence? What can be done in terms of knowledge base, in terms of training, capacity building, maybe at policy level?
Great, another very challenging question. I think this one.
Yeah, Jane Mudgwick, CEO of Wetlands International. Started this session saying, music to my ears, healthy ecosystems are the basis for sustainable agriculture. But if we look across sub-Saharan Africa, we actually see the continent littered with development schemes which were in the name of increasing food security. Mm-hmm. But when you look carefully, have actually undermined food security through, in particular, changing the water flows and the water allocations, taking water away from the fishers and the farmers, millions of people who depend on the natural ecosystems. So how, the question is, how can we bring the principles of WLE better into risk screening of these major development schemes, which are well-intended, but really maladaptive. So we're pulling together information that shows, actually, that far from climate being the biggest risk to these areas and to food security, actually just poorly informed development are by far the biggest risk. How can we make this risk screening more effective?
Well, excellent, excellent comment. Is there one more person who wants to have a comment just now? Simon.
Debbie, Simon Lane from the International Institute for Applied Systems Analysis. In opening or framing the discussion, Debbie, you described the two big pieces of international legislation, or not legislation, guidelines, UNFCCC and the climate change. And it seems to me that there we have a pathway on these SSP. So we have a pathway of how they should try to reduce this global society and try to reduce its emissions, and that trade-off between mitigation and adaptation. But when we look at the SDGs, where we have a set of goals, we don't have a pathway. So is one of the focus of WLE and the people in this room to look at that pathway, and it goes to that heart of implementation. It's fine having implemented policies as well, but unless we have a pathway to get how we get there. And then my second comment is I don't think any of the panelists mentioned the word capacity and what needs to be done in terms of capacity and the role of WLE and again the role of people in the room.
Yeah, interesting, interesting. On the SDGs, I take your point very much. The SDGs are riddled with trade-offs inherent in the different goals and everything. This is definitely an important area. What I'd like to do is, because listening to these comments, I see that almost all of you are asking the panel, yes, but what can we do about some of these issues? So that takes us to a question that I wanted to ask them anyway. In responding to these people, could each of you briefly give us an idea of some sort of solutions that you actually, things that are happening, things that you believe can happen that actually address some of the issues that, that people have raised? Let's just, we can just move down the row starting floor.
Sure. I think I'll just use the question that was asked of me in terms of here we have this land which is managed, 90% of it under customary systems. The majority of that actually is communal land, and where you have a common use of resources, and that's where the investments are also taking place. So this is land that looks to be bare, but it's actually land that is used by a whole lot of people, people with very marginalized livelihoods systems, you know, and policy where they, which does not reach them. So here the question is, how do we then convert this land into more productive land? I mean, I would go back, I think, to what the guiding principles are before moving to what can be done. So I think it was useful as a continent to come together and say, because the Nairobi Action Plan in 2010, we said, look, there's a lot of talk in, you know, around the food crisis, 2008, and the discussions are being held. You know, you see BBC, you see civil society, there was a lot going on. But as a continent, as member states, as civil society, what do we do about it? So the first thing that we said was, okay, we need to understand what's going on, and then quickly get to where civil society thought, put a moratorium, stop the investments before we figure out what it is. I mean, there's Donald Trump, stop it, and then figure out what it is. It doesn't always work. You know.
I told you.
No, Donald Trump, but we thought, I'm not saying no to him being elected, I'm just saying I'm not discussing that.
Yes.
But I think what we couldn't just stop investments from going on while we try to figure it out and then go back to the investments. It was not agreeable because we all did not have one voice on that. There are governments that actually thought that bringing land to production and governments with big tracts of land need to do that. But actually, eventually, some of them actually did stop and say, okay, we need to reevaluate, because we are not benefiting anyway. We need to reevaluate what's going on. So the first thing actually is most of them then thought, we need to include more people, which is what the guidelines are about, is including more people in the conversation. We need to identify who actually claims this land. We need to include them in discussing, but also as part of the solution in terms of the investment. So what you hear about in terms of inclusive models, a lot of research there needed. So here is an area for research that we need because it's not universal. In the Sargot area, it might be very different from somewhere else in terms of, you know, you have invested massively in agriculture, but you have not addressed the land tenure issues. The land use system is, you know, you don't have clear land use planning, which is done already and all that.
So can I ask you, so these voluntary guidelines exist, but how much are they implemented? How many actual schemes are implementing these guidelines at this stage?
Sure, so that's a capacity issue. Somebody mentioned there is no issue, the issue of capacity, and one of the things that we are doing right now with the support of donors, we're working closely with GIZ, I mean, the EU is involved, looking at IFPRI as part of our friends and FAO, we also have an MOU with them, is looking at it from different areas. First of all, we have spent a lot of time raising awareness of these guidelines, whether it's the voluntary guidelines or the African Union guidelines, amongst the governments, because they actually adopted them. It was actually not voluntary on the AU side. Oh. The voluntary guidelines on the CFS side is voluntary. Ours were not voluntary. So we actually would like to always remind our African governments that they did not volunteer to endorse the framework and guidelines. They actually are being held into account. But the other one was that we don't have the capacities, whether it is capacities for negotiators to be able to engage. In fact, identifying who the negotiators are. I think FAO is always calling to say, oh, these guys want to invest and they're asking for people to help them to do this. We actually identifying the bureaus of investments and getting them trained in terms of the different trade-offs that are involved in terms of that. So we are right now generating the material together with FAO to train on that. And my colleagues at home are trying to do that. So the capacity issue and also mapping this to universities, because capacity is needed in so many countries amongst traditional leaders, amongst government. It's too huge for you to have one course sitting somewhere in Nairobi or somewhere else doing this. So what we are doing with the support of the German government, for instance, is trying to look at a network of universities and institutions where you can anchor some of this training and link them in a network that we are calling the NELGA, the Network of Excellence on Land Governance in Africa, so that you can have training, not just of university students, but of land professionals, summer type courses in these kinds of areas. So that's the capacity side, but also the monitoring side. And if there's an area where we lack data, it's the area of land governance and property rights. And I think our colleagues from IFPRI and other countries have been trying to look at even where you're looking at household level data. But imagine we have 54 member states and we are trying to look at how we map this. So you have the guidelines, how do we know we are applying the guidelines? Where is it sensitive to do so? Well, in the context of the AU Declaration on Land, we actually asked to report at the AU summit in terms of who is doing what. So there is an opportunity for us to be able to, not name and shame, I don't call it that, but to be able to name who is doing what and where the best practices are. And in the process, you might shame, I'm not sure.
Name and shame has worked in a lot of situations.
Yeah, so the issue of monitoring is really central, and the issue of data and the issue of getting our think tanks involved in supporting governments to be able to track what's going on in terms of rights and also in terms of implementing good policies, but also in terms of the guidelines. To do so. So I'm just mentioning a few of them in addition to policies that actually address the realities of customary land governance and systems that recognize traditional institutions in the process.
Great, thank you.
But look at attracting investment into that.
How
can you take customary ownership and still attract investment by the people themselves, by banks and by other investors? Okay. I mean, because you have to get investment in. The current system that we can keep it, and I'm sure we're going to keep it. But how do we attract?
I think that it's just the basics. You know, you have to secure land rights so that you can feel like you're going to invest and your great-grandchildren will get the land anyway, or will get that investment, isn't it? So the first, it's very basic in terms of making sure that you're securing land rights of people, making sure that you document people's land rights. But you asked, is it the investors who should change?
This sounds like
is it the investors
really
who should change
for the lunch? This one is a very contentious topic, and also the India solar pump topic, a very good topic. I'd like to give a chance for the other panel members to mention some sort of solution or responses to the questions that we heard earlier.
Okay, I'll be brief. I just want to touch on some of the questions. There was a question about the do we need more food? Well, I think this is a contested issue, and I think this is a discussion that needs much more clever thinking. I didn't say that I said we needed to double food. I said the FAO said they needed to double food. And I also, in my background to exploring that statement a little while ago, it was a two-day meeting in Rome, so there was probably a few pizzas and drinks taken. And also, there was a little policy brief by, I think, the Soil Association of the UK in reaction to that statement, which is called Who's Telling Porkies? So it is definitely Who's Telling Porkies? Which is an English expression for lies. Porky, it's London slang, porky pies, lies. So for anybody who wants education in Cockney rhyming slang. On the fertilizer issue, which I think my personal view is that yes, despite being brought up in research world of eutrophication, we need to have more fertilizer use and better fertilizer use, but we need to have smart fertilizer use. And whether that's a combination of synthetic or recycling depends on the situation. We need to be smart and we need to have common sense. It's not just a fix, because that fix caused all sorts of problems in the US and Europe and elsewhere. Because to use an old adage, which I'm not saying I support, but it's certainly worth thinking about, the adage, if you remember from years ago, was free water is wasted water. You might also say free fertilizer is wasted fertilizer, and you might say free electricity is wasted electricity. So I'm not saying in all situations that's true, but it's worth thinking about. And then in capacity development, this underpins everything. I'm sorry I didn't mention it. It's just so an underlying component to any of these solutions. So if you want solutions, you've got to have awareness, intelligent discussion, the policy coherence, which is absolutely essential, and there were so many mismatches that, you know, I could bore you for ages on that. But the capacity development is key. But our mental model, I would pose to this audience that our mental model in general of capacity development is deeply flawed. And I think we need a complete rethink of what do we mean by capacity development, for who and by whom. So, you know, rolling out the same old capacity development stuff that's been rolled out for the last 40 years is not, it's, what does Einstein say? You know, there's something about the solution to the new problems is not making the mistakes of the past. And I think capacity development is a hugely important debate that underpins all of this, because without it, We are going nowhere.
An interesting comment from somebody from IHE, which dedicates itself to capacity.
Well,
this is great.
I think
good thing.
Let's get the debate.
Yeah. Jan, would you like to respond to some of the questions in the vein of solutions?
Just, I can just tell you something about what we are now doing and the response to several questions, partly maybe. And that's all about getting those silos down, also in policy making, because we were always quite working in sectors, water sector, food security sector. And now we are really working on cross-sectoral, on developing new approaches based on a more geographically defined areas. So, you know, the word is going around already for some years, landscape approach, etc. But we think that there are elements there that could really solve this more sectoral way of looking at it. And it comes all down to governance. I think multi-stakeholder approach to governance. But we want to. It's not new. In the past, in development cooperation, we did a lot of these rural development programs, etc. But they were always, they started always from, let's say, the governmental side. And we think now that we should much more, the drivers should come from investors, from private sector, I'm also talking about farmers, from smallholders who are, let's say, on their way to become farmers, trying to get those stakeholders together to talk more, to discuss sustainability of their environment. And, well, that's where we are working on now.
Yeah.
That's very interesting. It also ties in, again, a lot of the conversation now is much more about bringing the bottom up into this agenda that we have, either globally or nationally. Claudia, can you give us also a response to some of the comments in this vein of solutions? And
sure. Yeah, first, do we need more food? So I have to say something. From a Food Policy Research Institute. Yes. As long as we are moving from 7 to 10 billion people, and as long as we don't all want to weigh 62 kgs, someone did an alternative scenario, so everyone would weigh 62 kgs. If you don't all want to go on a diet, if you don't all want to only eat vegetarian and a few other things. As long as significant number of people spends 50 to 65% of their income on food, we can't just say we stop producing more, because unfortunately we will not be able to reach them. And as long as we have farmers who are both the most food insecure and the poorest, we can't just tell them, sorry, you stop producing food now, come all to Europe or whatever. So the debate has to continue. We have to be a lot smarter, and we have to be more tech savvy. Investments in agricultural research, have performed, but we are not investing enough, especially African countries still don't invest enough in ag research. We could do a lot better. I mean, I think that's the message there, but we do have to produce more food. Fertilizer, I wouldn't tax fertilizer, because again, already fertilizer is one of the most expensive inputs in Africa, and if you tax it, they'll use even less. What you should do is force the fertilizer industry to increase investment in R&D, which they never had to do anything over the last 50 years. They just keep selling the same thing. they didn't have to do anything, and now they finally start, and they really haven't done much yet. I would force them if you can't be more efficient, if your technology keeps generating this runoff and at this cost, you're out of date. So basically update your technologies. Also invest in nutrient use efficiency. So there's a lot of breeding going on. We can breed crops that generate outputs with the same fertilizer or the same output with a lot less fertilizer. But again, not enough investment has gone into that. And of course, closing the nutrient cycle is another big piece of that. So all these pieces have to be moved forward, but taxing yet something else or subsidizing yet something else, I don't think is the best answer. Also, just very quickly, smallholder agriculture can be as efficient, and sometimes it's more efficient than large-scale agriculture. So again, it very much depends on the location, on the crop, on the technology, but generally, yes, I mean, maybe are not less efficient because we are small. On the question, so what we might want to discuss in one of the working groups is how to make agricultural water climate smart, nutrition sensitive, gender equitable, and sustainable.
Okay.
So, obviously there's a lot of elements, and there's not a single solution, but how can we move across all these forms? I think that's the question we need to.
Great. Well,
obviously WLE is trying to, but we need more support and input to move that forward.
Great, Claudia, thanks. That was the last thing I wanted people to respond to. Jeremy, do you have a short intervention? Because we want to go to lunch soon.
Yeah, just want to come back to the point that Jane made, actually, because it was interesting. Challenge saying that effectively that the poorly planned development projects are more of a threat to food security for marginalized people than climate change. I think two things we need to do there are, one is to provide the evidence of what the implications are, and I think things like the Wise Up project, where we're looking at questions around, well, what are the implications of this development on, say, fisheries, capture fisheries or something like that? How can you manage those sorts of infrastructure differently? And you're also trying to overcome two things. One is perceptions that these big projects provide big solutions, and also vested interest. So providing evidence and raising awareness, but also, I think, providing alternatives. What are the options? Putting those options on the table, which are not there and not discussed, I think is necessary. But you have major barriers, I think, there to overcome, and hopefully that's something that a program like this can really help to achieve.
Thanks. So that's another point, I think, for taking forward into the discussions this afternoon. There's a lot of people in the room who haven't actually spoken yet. And so in the afternoon, we have this plan with the smaller groups where we can have more detailed discussions and follow through with these issues a bit more. So I hope that means everyone will get a chance to engage. What we wanted, with Claudia already started the process, was the very final thing from the panel before we go to lunch. So in 30 seconds, if you have a particular question or issue or challenge that you think should be discussed in the the working groups this afternoon. This is your chance to sort of raise that one issue. You've raised one, Claudia raised one. Maybe Jan, would you like to?
I just had the same, I think. That we should never forget stakeholders like fishermen, pastoralists, etc. I think we are working together in also in Mali, in the inner delta of the Niger. Mm-hmm. That's also the question there. I mean, do we have to develop it completely with irrigated rice, or are there also other people who depend on it?
So even within the agriculture and production arena, making sure to integrate various stakeholders, and then on top of that, various sectors, I think, in the landscape. That's, I think, core business for the WLE program. So that's a good topic to discuss this afternoon. Ken, would you like to give a last?
I think key issue is smart local agriculture, same thing, with an ecosystem perspective, connected with this awareness and capacity development at that local scale, because local scales are where things happen. And that's where the focus needs to connect then. You know, I think the gap, one of the, not only a silo, but a sort of a tier gap, is that connection between the what happens on the ground and the policy, and the, what are the steps between there? What are the different bureaucratic and governance steps between the local action and the policy, okay, and the awareness at that level?
Great, good. Joanne,
please. I think the gender dimension of all this, in everything that I think we're going to be discussing, I know for us, we have this decision that we have to achieve by 2025, and we are struggling with it. And that's a decision that by 2025, 30% of all documented, you know, women at least have 30% of all documented land. So number one, we need to increase the documentation. We need to record what is already owned or not owned. We're talking about ownership here and control. And so this is one thing we are struggling with. I'm wondering what else we need to struggle with to make it more a more equitable, a smart agricultural. I'm not going to use, it's not about smart climate smart. I'm talking about, you know, smart in the sense that number one, we need to focus in our investments where women are. Yeah. And the other one is that we need to minimize the consequences of those investments that we are making on marginalizing women further. Yeah. So I think in everything that we do is thinking through that gender dimension in recognition of the fact that we do need that as an input in terms of more equitable, sustainable development, I think.
Yeah. I think that's a great cross-cutting one for any of the groups this afternoon to address the gender question. I think we have, Anthony, would you like to?
Yeah, I was just going to say, it's more than gender now, it's about youth, it's about providing business opportunities and educational opportunities for the massive populations of youth in sub-Saharan Africa, so it's a broader thing.
Yep. Great, thank you. It's time for lunch, so I just want to thank the panel very much for taking time. And I hope that those of you who didn't have such a good idea about what the waterland ecosystem, what the CGIAR program is actually about, have a better idea now about the concepts and issues we're dealing with.
Okay, so for lunch, which is just outside, I heard some really interesting topics here. Capacity development, this is basically what this institute is all about education, master, MSc, and PhDs. There's a few of the MSc participants I see here happily in the room. I hope you stay also for lunch and keep on interacting and all those questions that you have, because I think it's a really nice opportunity for a program as WLE to interact with what UNESCO-IHE is about. Then there was the question, do we need more food? I think already mentioned there's like this individual and global, but I think as an individual, I think we are ready for some food now. So it's over there. We're going to be back here at 2:15, right?
Yeah, 2:15.
Yeah, 2:15. And there was another interesting remark. Please talk to people that you traditionally don't talk to. So I think this is a few challenges for the lunch. So enjoy your lunch. We see each other back at 2:15.